Hi, and welcome to our first podcast today with U.S. Family Office Realestate.com. Today, we're going to talk about real estate cycles, and we're fortunate today to have Akhil Patel, who is with Ascendant Strategy. He's out of the U.K., and he's a director and founder of Ascendant Strategy, which is an advisory business that helps investors and corporations take charge of their financial destiny by applying unique insights to the various cycles to make investment decisions. Akhil specializes in real estate, which we're going to talk about here today, but also the stock market and commodity cycles, which people can use this to make great long-term forecasts, help investors apply these to their investment strategies. So historically, Akhil has several years experience in banking, policy, audit, and corporate governance, and an experienced property investor and trader, and holds a master's degree in finance and public policy, as well as an undergraduate degree in the classics from Oxford University. Akhil, thanks for being on our podcast today.
Very pleased to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
Well, as you know, we were able to connect a number of months ago and whatnot, and a lot of that was because of the family office that I'm at. Historically, our patriarch has made his money based upon real estate cycles, and he's looked at the macroeconomic component. And in fact, you know, he sold 80% of his portfolio before the last downturn, and you know, looks at the cycle in various areas. However, because of that, I started doing some research into the various real estate cycles and ran across yourself and your expertise. And you know, in fact, we're very excited that you're going to be part of the U.S. Family Office Real Estate website. And you know, with the way that the economy is today, I think it's a perfect fit in order to start you with our first podcast and talk about a little bit about the real estate cycle, especially after the downturn that we last had. So
absolutely.
Yeah. So let me ask you a question. You know, what initially made you get involved and interested in these, in looking at the cycles, which seem to me to go back, you know, not only, you know, decades, but actually centuries?
Well, the first time I really started studying them seriously was in around 2006, which was in the U.S., the very peak of the real estate cycle the last time around. And when people started talking about, you know, there was some kind of divergence in opinion. Probably real estate professionals were starting to see weaknesses in parts of the real estate market, particularly starting in California with subprime mortgages. And policymakers were talking about, even at the time, the great moderation with, you know, stop the boom and bust cycle. In the UK, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, which is the same as the Secretary to the Treasury in the US, claimed to have tamed the boom and bust cycle. And I started wondering if people really knew what was going on. And so I started doing some research on, you know, what is the economic cycle? How does it work? Is it regular? Can you use it to time your investment decisions? And I found that actually very few people really kind of had the historical perspective on what goes on, and that really made me quite interested. And so I started doing research on this subject, and have identified, you know, based on the work of a lot of other people, I have to say, a very regular 18 to 20 year cycle in the US and also in other Western economies, particularly the UK, which seems to catch everyone by surprise when you get to the peak and then you have a major economic bust and the housing market goes down. The stock market typically crashes by about 50%, and everyone, you know, seems to be quite worried about the future. Unemployment goes up, and then things are sorted out and they start again, and the next cycle happens and people forget the lessons of the previous one.
Now, okay, so one of the questions, you know, that might come to some of the listeners here is that you're based in the UK. So is it, with us being in the United States, I mean, is it Does that still make it relevant in the U.S.? Are there similarities? What is it that you found?
It's a very good question. I actually spend most of my time focusing on the U.S., primarily because the U.S. is the dominant economy in the world and typically leads other countries into and out of the real estate cycle. And so if you want to know what's going to happen in the U.K., you just follow what's happening in the U.S., and we tend to lag the U.S. by about 6 months. So actually, most of my expertise is based upon what's happening in the U.S. Economy, the stock markets, and the real estate market.
So why do these cycles happen? What did you find?
Well, essentially, the economy is structured in a particular way. And this is, this is going back centuries. It's not anything new. Nothing has really fundamentally changed in our capitalist economies. And what they do is it sort of incentivizes real estate speculation. And so during an economic cycle, real estate investors can make very large gains. But the problem is that they're quite susceptible to going over the top. Essentially, if it's sort of slightly informal way of putting it, but when speculators jump on the bandwagon and everyone's kind of involved in slightly sort of less than kind of robust investment in real estate, essentially what happens is that this sort of transmits itself into the banking system, because much of what goes on in the real estate market is financed by banks. And when banks start to turn down because, real estate investments maybe have gone over the top, you then find that these effects affect how much banks will lend to businesses. And if businesses don't have access to bank financing and to credit, then they turn down as well, and they lay people off, and that reduces demand in the economy, and it basically transmits itself throughout the economy. And then the government has to step in to bail the banking system out, and that takes a number of years to work through. And then you kind of have a reset, and the whole thing starts again. And since the reason to answer your question why these things happen over and over is because fundamentally that process never changes, and it hasn't changed since the birth of the U.S. and the U.K. It's not changed since probably the 16th century.
So what you're saying is we can go back quite some time. We can see this happening over and over again. Where would you know as a real estate investor that you're getting close to that time? Are there any certain indicators? You had mentioned about the banks and whatnot. When is it the time to really pull back, do you think, based upon where one would be at within the cycle?
There are a number of indicators. No one indicator is by itself a perfect provides you a perfect warning of the real estate cycle. But you can typically see it. You've had several years of fairly robust growth in the real estate market. You start to see that banks loosen their lending standards. It makes it very easy to obtain finance. The stock markets have been doing very well, and the economic picture is generally very strong and very robust. And it's at that point, from my point of view, you would be on the lookout for a potential correction, and then you typically see the first signs of it in the stock market, actually. And that's one of the reasons why I combine study of real estate cycles with stock market cycles, because stock markets tend to anticipate economic problems. And so when you for example, a sign is real estate stocks are not doing quite as well as the rest of the market, banking stocks similarly, because a lot of real estate companies are reliant on banks, and a lot of banks are reliant on real estate companies and their mortgage business. So the stock market often provides the first warning, but actually it's time to step back, hold cash if you can, because one of the great things about the real estate cycle is when it turns down, you find some fantastic deals that are available, which can really set you up for the next cycle.
Right, and that's where, you know, our family office has done extremely well. I mean, he's been through three cycles, and he's been able to have an idea on that. I don't know if it's to the extent that, you know, you're able to speak to, but it's definitely proven that there are deals to get when that market comes down. Now, with a lot of these theories, Akhil, seem to be, you know, I don't know how much of it was taken into consideration globalization. So with the way that the world economy is today, do you see that changing how this historical real estate cycle has worked in the past?
That's a really good question. Yes, it is definitely changing things. And because globalization is probably, you know, a phenomenon that's only been with us in its current form for the last, say, 20 or 30 years, you know, we don't have a huge amount of experience, but what appears to be happening is that a lot of real estate markets are becoming quite synchronized. And so essentially, you get even bigger booms, and then I suspect that you will start to get even bigger busts. And the events of, 2006 to 2010, when you had this really kind of massive boom, and then, you know, the world seemed to go into a major recession, it seems to be the case that, you know, that process will be the impact of globalization, and particularly with a lot of capital being able to move across borders very quickly and very freely, you know, money will go into hot real estate markets, and when those turn down, it will go straight out, which will, you know, increase the bust, as it were, and it will sort of find another home. And when that market is ready to turn down, it will find somewhere else. I think that's basically what you're starting to see. But it does appear to be the case that it will primarily start with the U.S. because, as I said before, the U.S. is still the major economy in the world, and certainly is possibly the most open as well. So
I know that, you know, primarily our focus initially is on the U.S. With U.S. FamilyOfficeRealEstate.com. However, and you might have talked about this a little bit earlier, but have you seen that even though they're sort of working in sync or working toward that, that there are still that countries are still in different parts of the cycle? And so it's, when you say the word sync, I mean working in a similar fashion, but not exactly, so that there are, you know, different, like I said, countries are at different points of time.
Yeah, that's a really good question. The historical evidence isn't there as yet for me to provide a definitive answer. I would go back to the 19th century just to maybe provide some clues as to what might happen going forward. And the reason is because in the 19th century, and certainly the early part of the 20th century, the U.S. and the U.K. economies were, you know, of a more similar size compared to the huge disparity that there is now between the U.S. and the U.K. And during the 19th century, the U.S. had its kind of major peak, and then the U.K. would have its major peak about sort of, 6 to 9 years later. And then it would have its bust, and then the U.S. 6 to 9 years later would have its peak, and then its bust. And so they almost seem to be having the opposite cycle, as it were. You might get a similar scenario between the U.S. and China going forward. But China has only, you know, recently joined the sort of capitalist system. I mean, some might argue it's not really even fully joined it as yet. And so you might start to find that the Chinese economy has a major boom, as it seemed to do after, say, 2010, while the Western world was, still going through the recessions and working out the problems from the previous cycle, and now China seems to be slowing down.